because everybody seems.
As an organization, as a society, as a civil society, to really help bring that out in people. So 20 years in.
Prominent in after the second wave of feminism, which was the early 70s, we thought heaven had opened for us. We thought, you know, women, you know, by the time our children are 20 years old, everything will be open to them, it'll be all wonderful, et cetera, et cetera. Well, it didn't happen, and it's not going to happen without a lot of fighting back and a lot of continued push. And that is now true for the LGBTQ. It's true for all of that. And, you know, the idea that, you know, if you had one or two women, I had this wonderful phrase, which is colloquial English, of being the only broad on the board. I was the only broad on the board of our major trust company, which, by the way, not because of me, went bankrupt. And it was really horrifying, but it was a very interesting examination to me of how men work together. I've never written about it, but I might at some time, because I saw how men actually grouped together and protected what was not worth protecting in a huge financial institution, which suffered a lot because of that and had history, etc. And so I think we have to be really, really careful not to think that women have had it all because they now have so many places, etc. There's still an endemic thing. And of course,
I'll give you all the love I've got. que una también. Okay, and we are back again. This is the second half of the day, and the guests are almost all back, so have fun.
The last few days at the Gallen Symposium, we talked about the changing nature of work. 360 today, we're going to talk about the changing nature of society. And so I'm going to now thank you so much for the interventions and questions this morning. It was a fabulous and lively discussion. We expect this afternoon to be just as fabulous and lively. I'm going to pass now the mic over to our host for this afternoon, Charlie Foran.
Thank you, Marty. Big hand for shy Scott Young in this morning's conversation. That was really excellent. There he is now. And welcome to 360 Societies. I'm delighted to be joined. Three of the four people on this stage you were expecting to see. Adrienne Clarkson, and of course Alexander. Hadil Ibrahim, we were very sorry to lose to a family emergency. She was unable to join us today, but we are very pleased indeed to be joined by Alicia Cromer. Alicia is a member of the board of directors, a UN delegate, and a human rights educator, and currently working with Incomindios. So say it again for me.
Incomindios,
Switzerland, which is the International Committee for the Indigenous Peoples of the Americas. Thank you, Alicia, for coming and joining us.
Thank you.
So we are going to move from the economic case for inclusion to arguments that focus on society, on our lives as citizens, neighbors, friends, even simply as fellow humans, sharing the same space, the same air, the same dreams and hopes, and I believe, and hope, the same responsibilities towards each other. As Scott said earlier today, any discussion about inclusion must be a discussion about dealing with structures built by a group largely for that group, no matter whether they proclaimed universality at the time or declared it somehow the collective work of the citizen or the people as so defined by themselves. That is coming clear as a core 6 degrees given, an irrefutable fact, the starting point for any honest exploration on how to go about identifying, critiquing, and helping evolve those same structures and institutions, be they foundational to economic activity, governance, education, policing, media, entertainment, transportation, public spaces, corporate culture, you name it. And yes, in May 2018, that may mean examining bias, conscious and unconscious, embedded not only in mainstream society or the dominant group, but even in less in well-meaning and self-critical efforts like this one, say, 6 Degrees St. Gallen, hosted by the Institute for Canadian Citizenship, and bias presumably well-meaning, embedded in presumably well-meaning and reasonably self-critical moderators of conversations like this one seated before you. Because putting aside my own visible markers of identity, my gender, race, background, education, language, mentioned earlier, English, the world's lingua franca, putting all that aside, putting aside the unintentional and unearned bequeathments that, to use a perhaps overly North American metaphor, may make me think I hit a home run when I really started on third base. Putting these particulars aside, the sad, challenging human fact is that privilege, entitlement, are almost never fully the program of some generalized other, never mind the gender, race, or class status. In the end, they are almost always, usually, us, too, played out in different forms and in different contexts. And for sure, because it is 2018, we must also factor in that simultaneous with movements to be more honest and reflective about biases around power and entitlement and who gets through the door and who doesn't and who built the door and what they were thinking when they built it, we also have to confront our own very raw, very divisive age. It is an age, after all, when an Australian minister of immigration can say that his nation now only wants immigrants from civilized countries. It is an age when an American politician can declare that we can't restore our civilization with someone else's babies. And that the culture, quote, of third world foreigners is antithetical to liberal Western values. Values in this case not referencing fairness or inclusion or even boilerplate Christian beliefs, but simply, quote, high income and a high quality of life. If nothing else, that is a nicely twisted mashup of our two 360s at 6 Degrees St. Gallen, the economic case and the social case, in this instance, for exclusion. Public assertions of exclusion, in fact, are everywhere visible right now, and they're troubling in their aggressivity and lack of apology, or even the usual cloaking. That they are falling back so often on a defense of the social structures many of us are coming to believe actually require close examination and most likely restructuring, defending our civilization, our high quality of life, apparently our babies, too, makes conversations like this one we are about to have all the more urgent, and the need to come up with good language, the theme running through 6 degrees, to counter this ugly, loud noise all the more essential. So our task, first inside this small circle, and then inside the larger circle of this room, is not our tasks are not small. We only have, I'm now seeing, 75 minutes to do this. Luckily, we have wonderful people in this small circle to start us off. I'd like to start by asking each of our on-stage participants to get them warmed up, maybe a rude or at least a raw question. I'd like you to answer it as honestly and as instinctively as you can. Is inclusion, feeling naturally empathetic towards and welcoming to people not quite like yourself and your immediate circle, natural to whom human behavior and to the societies that emerge out of that behavior? Aya, I start with you. Is it possible humans find excluding those they don't know aren't quite like themselves easier than including them?
I can only answer that from a personal experience, and yes and no. Yes, I grew up in different cities around Tunisia. I studied in 8 different schools because my dad worked in the military and we had to move every year. So I lived like a nomad and I saw the mosaic of Tunisia that today I would have never thought is possible. the indigenous people, the diversity of background, of color, of how people live and inequality. But no, because I had to unlearn all the political propaganda, being Arabized and being Islamized, and I had to learn for myself my African identity, and I had to explore that myself, and my political system did not provide that. So yes and no, I think it depends on the way you grew up and the environment, but the systems of oppression have to do with it as well, on if you grow up with a natural or unnatural feeling of inclusion.
Okay, Alexander.
I think when you enter the world, I think we all instinctively recognize our shared humanity. For me, I think power and privilege are something that are learned and taught and given. And it's through those experiences, through those interactions in which you are provided power and privilege, which you haven't earned, they are just given to you based upon the structure of society, that then normalizes the exclusion that we see in the world. So with each of those interactions, as each year passes, you get to a point where you start to not even recognize what behaviors are governing the society. You get to a point where, for example, in Canada, where there's for Indigenous youth, there's a suicide rate that's 7 times higher than non-Indigenous Canadians. Mm-hmm. You get to a point where boil water advisories exist in your country, in a country in which which is fifth on the UN Human Development Index, unless you look at purely Indigenous people, then we drop down into the 40s. And that becomes, if not normal, at least you don't recognize it. That's not where you put your energy and your passion and your anger and sense of justice. And so I think it is something that is, our shared humanity is intrinsic in all of us, and it is over time and through the experiences that we collect over time that we start to learn how to be exclusive and create those boundaries that we do see in the world.
Alicia, natural, unnatural?
I think on a very personal level, I think everyone naturally wants to be included. I was the youngest of four growing up. I always wanted to be included with my brothers and sisters, whether they liked that or not. And I grew up in southwestern Ontario, and I am white, blonde hair, blue eyes, and I was part of the majority. So this sense of inclusion, this wasn't an issue for me growing up. I went to school in Vancouver, and I happily found myself in a different situation where in one of my classes at UBC, I was the only white person and the rest were Asian. And it was a phenomenal, wonderful experience. And it was an inverse situation for me. And I just thought that spoke to the fantastic diversity of Canada. Mm-hmm. And then I moved abroad to Austria and later to Switzerland. And it was the first time for me, even acknowledging my white privilege, where I struggled with a sense of being included, of feeling, how do I belong into this new society? And for the first time, even as a Canadian, and saying, yes, we live in a multicultural society and are inclusive of all cultures, I experienced what it was like to be an immigrant, albeit with my white privilege, and to see there are tremendous obstacles to overcome. And for people with less privilege, even more obstacles. So yes and no. Inclusion, I think we all naturally desire inclusion. And in other situations, there's obvious obstacles to this for many people.
Okay. Adrienne.
I think that inclusion, if I look at my own life, I feel very fortunate in that when we came to Canada, we were accepted and we had an interesting life. But when I look at my own family, and Don DeLillo, who's one of my favorite writers, American writers, says the family is the source of all bad things, misconceptions. It closes in on itself. It makes you believe that myths about things. And I suppose we all have things like that in our families. My family was terrific, but my mother had very racist attitudes towards certain races, I will say that. And I always, tried to ignore that or not go there, as they say, and just not deal with it because it wasn't there. My father, on the other hand, was a marvelously wonderful person who'd grown up in great poverty as a Chinese in Australia in a village of 60 people, where his mother was a cleaning lady and his father had a little grocery store
And so he grew up feeling, you know, very much on the outside, very much an outsider, but had a wonderful character. That's the only thing I can say. And he eventually, when he went to Hong Kong, he did extremely well. He, you know, that was great. But when he was little, he felt very excluded. And I think he never wanted to feel that he would exclude other people. When I was little, when he was traveling in the car, he would always pick up hitchhikers and bring them home for dinner, to the horror of my mother. And we, you know, he said, this man is a rubby-dub. And a rubby-dub is a person who drinks and lies about, is homeless generally. And we're going to have supper with him. He's going to tell us all about how he gets alcohol when he can't get it from the store. And so I've never forgotten, I must have been about 8, he showed us through a loaf of bread how to strain hand lotion so that the alcohol would come out to the bottom and the cream would stay there. Then you sucked the alcohol.
Right.
When I'm desperate, I do that. But otherwise, I buy vanilla. So my father had this feeling that we should know everybody, and not that we would be like them, but that we should know it. And my mother would put the dinner on the table, and then she would leave because she didn't want to be involved with that, and she never made a comment about it. She would basically, I think in her mind, she said, that's him dealing with the children. That's fine. Let him deal with it and the consequences. And we never became alcoholics, and we didn't do anything bad. But so I grew up with that kind of mixture of things. Then I went to France when I was a student, was 21, and I realized that in France, you were a foreigner. You went and registered at the police station as a foreigner. It was the first time I'd ever been in a police station and stated my name in my life. But as a foreigner, you had to do that in France and get a card that identified you. And I realized that I was automatically excluded. And then living in France for 3 or 4 years when I perfected my French and did a good degree and all the rest of it, I still thought, it's wonderful, all of this culture is available to me now, etc. But I knew I would never belong there.
Right.
I knew that I would always be excluded.
Right.
There. Excluded. And so I still like France very, very much. We live part of the year there. But I know I'm not going to belong there. And I don't look for that. I don't look for that feeling that they're going to welcome me as belonging in France. They think I'm just fine because I speak very good French and right. because I understand French history.
Right. But let me just say, I think only Alexander answered the question exactly in the way I kind of want it. Because I think,
Sorry.
You said, yes, but something happens and you don't wind up. Mm-hmm. Practicing inclusion because you have too much skin in the other game. My own view is we're naturally tribal and closed,
yeah.
and we defend instinctively and we can we prefer to people right around us. I've asked Seguin to start the conversation with the people outside the circle. Marty, would you throw over to the young woman there and tell me where you coming out of.
I would disagree with you, actually. In terms of our generation, I think that inclusion and diversity is actually pretty natural. And I think that digitization and technology has really enabled the visibility of the wide types of variety of diversity that we arrange our societies. I disagree with you.
Okay. Aya, you said earlier that for you, social media or a different way of connecting is a differentiator.
I think, as I said previously, digital space can be inclusive, especially when you live under oppressive regimes. I'm a blogger, and I use online space to speak up. But then the digital space can also be exclusive. Especially when you talk about narratives, when mainstream narratives become the mainstream, then your story becomes the exclusion. Maybe just a question, how many people know about the Tunisian Revolution here? How many people know about the Arab Spring?
Couple of more hands on. So the Arab Spring, for example, is a Western narrative. In Tunisia, we call it the revolution of dignity. You might use the Arab Spring as a normal word in your everyday conversation, but it excludes the diversity of North Africa, that we have indigenous people called Amazigh, we have Gnawa, we have Nubians, we have Shilha. And it really put us in this box where you're this homogeneous region, and that is used politically, used economically, used to propagate other exclusionary policies. So I think especially about narratives and the digital space, I think narrative become a place of belonging and identity, and we need to ask ourselves who shaped narrative and whose voice is heard. And we say so many times we want our voice heard, but making our voices heard doesn't mean speaking on behalf of people. It means elevating and amplifying the voices of the most vulnerable. And that is not happening online.
Okay, it is happening. It's not.
It's not.
It's not okay.
Yeah.
I want to come back to narratives in a second, but actually I want to reframe something just to get clarity. Is because you seem to suggest, I have daughters around your age, and they also believe that inclusion is natural. And I keep thinking, I just think you haven't yet grown old and watched people turn really ugly and bad. Now,
doesn't that mean that inclusion is not natural? It's learned.
Well,
it's our exclusion.
Marty, I'm wondering if there's a generational thing. I wonder if there's a generational thing going on here.
Okay.
Before we go to him, can we? Anybody over the age of 40 who struggles with the idea that inclusion is natural? Am I the only one?
I am.
All right. Okay. And every younger people, is there general agreement that you feel inclusion is a natural state? No? No. Okay. So, all right. We definitely have to go at this a little bit more. And then we'll come back to narratives. Who are we going to, Marty?
Over there, then over here.
All right, please. I understand, yes. But I'm trying to understand if there's a gap there. If it has... Yes.
Can I just add something, Charlie?
Sure, please.
Very interesting. As Governor General, I was responsible for giving out the rewards for bravery on a national basis. This was one of the most wonderful and memorable things I did in 6 years, which is about 40 people a year would get a star of bravery or a medal of bravery for doing things like saving someone from drowning, saving somebody from a burning house, doing all sorts of things. And before I became Governor General, when I read about these in the papers, I would always somehow think it was somebody going in and rescuing somebody they knew or a neighbor or whatever. In fact, I did the statistics. I had the office do them. 85% of people who did brave things and saved people's lives did not know that person. Had no connection with them. Example, a man is driving down the Fraser River. It's flooding-ish because it's spring. It's very cold in the Fraser River in April. He sees a woman attempting to commit suicide by jumping off a bridge into the Fraser River. He stops his car. He goes into the river, fully dressed, and rescues her. Brings her to the car, takes her to the hospital. Never sees her again. But he is picked up by the police. They know the whole story. He saved her at the risk of his own life. Or example, 12 people are having coffee in a shop on a major highway in Saskatchewan, and they hear that a car is starting to burn, a large tanker truck on the highway. They have to go and help and rescue the driver, they feel. They rush out in their various cars, they rescue the driver, they pull him aside. About 5 seconds later, the whole tanker blows up to such an extent the highway has to be closed for 2 days to be resurfaced.
Okay.
They didn't know each other. Okay, they didn't know each other, but the reason they did all of this was to save somebody from the human race. And I think it is something embedded in our DNA as human beings from when we became humanoids and defeated the Neanderthals that we want to save every single one of us.
On the generation, can I add one thing?
Because
I think Yasmin's point of distinction is important. What I'm talking about is the tools that we have today are exclusive and can be used to be inclusive or exclusive. But in defense of what you're saying, I think, yes, our generation is more inclined toward inclusion because your generation try to build nation states and put borders and police them, and our generation is saying we want free movement and we want borderless continents. So there is an inclination towards inclusion that is not the same
because
with your
generation. Operating outside, you think, or you're thinking outside the nation
because of so many things. One of them is digital and being so interconnected, but also meeting other people from other cultures is exciting, and a lot of innovation and ideas come out. And we also identify identity different from the 60s and 70s. We have more fluid identity, more discussion about
it. Right, we discussed that this morning a bit, yeah. We're going to come back to narrative, but I think a lot of people want to talk, get clarity on this natural and natural business. Okay, yes.
Yeah, so I...
Please stand up.
So I wanted to kind of ask you a question. I am a foreign student in France. I've been studying there for 5 years now. And what I noticed is that it is true, it's hard to be, well, let's say the society is not as, let's say, open as American one, for instance. But at the same time, younger generation does accept, as a student at a university or a business school, I don't feel excluded in the community of students. However, what I noticed, I have a few friends who graduated and who tried to enter, let's say, professional part of the French society. And that was becoming, let's say, very difficult for them to be included in that part, even though the difference between, let's say, the age, you know, the young professionals were the same generation as us. So I'm wondering, is this not just the question of, let's say, age, but also what do you do? Do you fall in the category, let's say, a student, or do you fall in the category as a potential employee and, you know, the one who takes the job?
Okay, thank you. Let's get a couple more people before we...
Got two over here.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Abhijit from India. I work in villages and refugee camps, and if they were here, they would be laughing their ass out if we asked them.
Why would they be laughing?
Oh, because you would ask them, are we being more inclusive, and they're in a refugee camp. I mean, come on. keeping that aside, because the question is it natural? And to understand nature, you have to see it from an evolutionary point of view. So when we were less humans, less number of humans and more resources, we hardly interacted. As the number of humans increased and the populations increased and sort of matched with the resources, we started interacting with each other, we started cooperating with each other. That was some small inkling of inclusion, a small level of it. But then resources reduced and the number of people just increased way, way more. And then we start competing. And we saw, and this is evidence again through AI. There was a recent experiment where they did the same thing with AI, and AI started cheating and backstabbing each other once the resources were too low.
Really?
Yes.
All right.
I'm an AI engineer, so a little bit. but not on the single quality of empathy. And empathy is a very, very advanced emotion. It is an emotion that takes a long time to evolutionarily come about. We are at the very, very beginning of that. We don't truly empathize. We can't really feel what the other person is feeling. We can fake it a little bit. We can try, but we don't truly empathize. But then the fact that we are having this conversation shows that we are trying to move in that direction. But this conversation has to include many, many more diverse sets of people. We are still from the 1%.
Okay.
That's all I want to say.
Thank you. I'm going to come back to. I'd like to come back to empathy later in discussing social inclusion. But yeah, a couple more, please.
Hi, everybody. My name is Laure. It's more of a personal storytelling, and I'd be happy to continue after if people feel like I feel. So, I'm French American, born and raised in France. Yet I was always seen as the American girl. Then I studied in the US, but in the US I was always the French girl. So in my childhood, I never seemed to fit in a country. My professional life, I never worked in France or the US. I've been working around the world for a nonprofit and the UN. And I was moving a lot, so never fitting, but I didn't really want to fit. I was just going, never for more than a few months. And then I wanted to root somewhere, fit somewhere, so I decided to work and stay in Haiti. So I've been in Haiti for 6 years, but I will always be the white girl. And I'm not trying to be Haitian, I'm not. But I have a sense that so we've been talking about inclusion and perception. So what does it really mean? Is it the society that makes us feel part of a place, or is it our own perception and feeling, okay, I feel good here, I feel like I belong here? So I'm just wondering if it happens to others to feel like they never really fit somewhere, and do we need to fit somewhere to be happy or not? Or like, it's just to keep thinking further about perception, inclusion, fitting in places or not. So happy to continue discussion later on.
Back to the stage for a second, because you're raising some great points. Yes.
Oh, hi, I'm Angela. I'm from New Zealand. 3 years ago, I went to the US. I was doing research at Harvard, and so I made some good friends there. And then the 2016 election happened, and Trump got elected. And almost all of them told me that they decided to unfriend all their conservative friends on Facebook. So when we talk about inclusion, do we talk about inclusion of the diversity of thought? Which I think sometimes when we talk about inclusion, we forget that we try and take this high road. But why are we taking this high road? By saying that we take the high road, we introduce a power dynamic. So are we suddenly better than conservatives? Is that what we're saying when we say that we're progressive? So I think that's the challenge I want to throw out to people, is that I've also had feedback in this forum that people said that they had difficulties talking to people who do not follow their progressive thought. And I think that, again, that's, we're shutting a group of people out. And do we really listen to them, or are we already judging? Thank you.
Would you like to pick up on anything that you've just heard?
Yeah, I would like to pick up on narrative, empathy, and inclusion here, also a bit of what you said. So narrative has been a very important part of the research I've done in Canada. And also, when I was doing PhD research in Canada, when I was based in Vienna, I needed to talk to Indigenous people. Growing up in Canada on Six Nation territory, in London, Ontario, I had no education whatsoever about Indigenous people, Indigenous languages, Indigenous history, nothing. And it wasn't until I moved away from Canada that I started learning about them. I did not even know an Indigenous person. So I was 24 years old the very first time that I met an Indigenous person in Canada. And this person took me to a residential school in Brantford, Ontario, called the Mohawk Institute. To me, Brantford was always famous for producing Wayne Gretzky, Canada's most famous hockey player. And I had been there many times for my brother's hockey tournaments. I had never known that it was on the other side a place of one of the darkest chapters in Canadian history. It was one of the first and longest running residential schools in Canadian history, the Mohawk Institute. It's now the Woodland Cultural Center run by Indigenous school survivors. This woman brought me into the room where she was abused, and by the principal of that school, who was principal of that school for over 30 years, and she then went on to describe in detail the abuse that happened in this room.
Alicia, could you explain quickly for the non-Canadians residential schools?
Yes, yeah. So
I'm sure you'll be familiar with the concept. But
so in Indigenous residential schools, they were previously called Indian residential schools. They started pre-Canada, pre-1867, with missionaries coming and starting schools to Christianize and civilize children. And then it started in earnest in 1867 when Canada became a country. The peak of the system was in the 20s, but the last school closed in 1996. And it was a federal policy to take Native children from their homes and put them in schools far from their communities and families, where they weren't allowed to speak their mother tongue, they weren't allowed to practice their spiritual customs. So, and there was a lot of physical and sexual abuse going onto these schools. And this was 7-8 generations where this happened, creating incredible amounts of trauma within the Indigenous community across Canada.
And just to add that the government gave the churches, that is the Catholic, the Protestant, and the Anglican churches, the run of these schools.
Exactly.
They divided them up.
Yeah, the federal government funded the schools and the churches were the staff and they administered the schools. Right. This woman, who was tremendously brave, also hilarious and spunky at the same time, she told me this horrific story, and I sat there and I said, how on earth are you able to tell me this story, to share this narrative with me? And she looked at me and she said, because I'm taking power back where power was taken from me.
Through narrative, through the telling of the story.
Exactly.
And in that room.
And in that room. That changed my life, hearing that, because I saw through her telling her story, being brave, facing the past, going into the very place where power was taken from her, and then speaking and teaching and engaging with other people, engaging with non-Indigenous people, and saying, this is what happened to me. She took her power back and continues to do that, serving on the board, and she's coming to Zurich, Switzerland, to give a talk about residential schools, and I was just like, yeah, you go, girl, because she really demonstrated this empowerment through engagement, through interaction, and through narrative.
Okay. I want to go back to the main question, not because I don't think what you said is very important, and it relates to what I was saying, and but it still seems to me that societies are composed of very powerful structures, and the structures are made by one group of people, usually with the self-interest of that group of people largely in mind. So if social inclusion is going to happen, the structures need to be identified and changed, do they not?
Or encouraged with their good.
Okay. Alexander, we're going to stay for a little minute, I think, with Canada. How would you wish Canada to change its governance to be more inclusive or simply to honor, respect, acknowledge Indigenous people?
Great question, and a big question as well. I think what you're seeing in Canada right now, and you know, I work within the reconciliation space, but I think you could say it, you know, for diversity and inclusion efforts more broadly, is that we're at this point where we're in the reconciliation piece of the work, but people fail to recognize that it's the truth in reconciliation piece. And that there's that truth that has to happen. And within that is the recognition of some of these systems that continue to exist. So, you know, those residential schools, those were established and directed through the Indian Act. The Indian Act is still in existence in Canada today, with modifications, of course, but it continues to function. So,
Alexander, give me a couple of examples, because I'm going to hazard a guess that anyone who grew up in a colonized country, raise your hand if you didn't grow up in a colonized country. Did not. Okay. Those of you who did will recognize the systemic blocks. Give a couple of examples of systemic disincentives to Indigenous people, or even more forceful than that.
Yeah, so the Indian Act not only established the reserve system, so that resulted in displacement, that resulted in loss, that for Indigenous peoples who are so intrinsically tied to the land and to their territory, there was that separation, there was, like I said, that loss. Indigenous peoples in Canada, it was the middle of the 20th century when they were finally able to vote.
The vote just recently.
Yeah.
1960.
Becoming a doctor or a lawyer at a time resulted in a loss of status. Marrying outside resulted in a loss of status. There's still, within the Indian Act, discrimination towards Indigenous women in that regard. So there's a whole set of, and those are just the formal policies. And then there is everything that was created as a result of those policies, all of the things that were deemed to be acceptable. So, for example, I have on my lapel the Moose Hide campaign, which is raising awareness around missing and murdered Indigenous women in this country. And that was something where the federal government and the RCMP, so that's our federal policing department, were largely complicit in the loss of life of Indigenous women for decades. And it's only now coming to the surface. And that's the type of behavior that is enabled through these systems. So in terms of your question about what I would like to see, I think it starts with a fundamental reexamination of some of our founding structures. You know, the Indian Act, even our Constitution, you know, look at the black and white grainy photos of who was in the room to create those documents.
Who was in the room?
All old white men.
Right.
So if that's what we're starting with, if those documents are guiding the work that we're doing now, even the best intentioned work, we are still guided by those limited lived experiences. So that, for me, it starts with that fundamental rethink of those documents. So re-examining the Indian Act, looking at Section 35 in our Canadian Constitution. So that's the part of our Constitution that looks specifically at Indigenous status and nationhood.
Right.
And then, but from that is then also the behaviors that have to change. And that, I think, is a big piece as well.
Behaviors.
And just to add on to that really quickly, the TRC was such a hugely... Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which happened in Canada from 2008 to 2015.
Modeled on the South African...
And this was an important mechanism in Canada, even though it was a branch of the federal government, which it shouldn't have been. It should have been out of a grassroots movement. But the Indigenous groups who helped create it, they were struggling for this for a long time. The results of the TRC was that before the TRC happened, it was less than a third of Canadians knew about the residential school. After the TRC, according to scholar Mariana Castellano, 80% of Canadians knew about the devastating impacts. This created a paradigm shift, at least in the past couple of years, where Canadians began to understand, especially the youth, non-Indigenous youth became very interested in this. And it was also started to be being taught at the provincial levels in different schools and high schools and elementary schools and universities. So this paradigm shift was critical, which also helped influence public policy, because the TRC came out with the 94 calls to action, and this influenced federal policy.
Yes. Please, Elizabeth, and while you answer, yes, please. People think, I like people from other countries to think of examples of where a narrative momentum has changed minds or raised consciousness while we're answering questions. But you, Alexander, and then I, and then out to Scott. Okay, can you do it in 30 seconds?
Very quickly, I think just in terms of, we're talking a lot about narrative, a lot about storytelling. I think we also need to acknowledge that there's a limitation to that. We're talking here today about inclusion being a choice. I think inclusion has to be a priority. I think it's great that these conversations are starting in Canada, but I think, and these diversity and inclusion conversations are happening, but for an Indigenous child growing up on reserve, that doesn't change their reality. That doesn't change the fact that they may not graduate high school, they may face systemic racism, they may, as was the case in the prairies in the middle of Canada, they may be their life may be taken by a non-Indigenous farmer who was then acquitted by an all-white jury. So that's where I think, you know, I think narrative is important, but I think we also need to ensure that the conversation includes action.
Okay. And then out to you.
Maybe I have not a good example of narrative. We have, you know, many Tunisians going to fight in Daesh and subscribing to violent groups.
And you work with that,
right? I work on that, but many of the policy narrative around that is that it's economic, it's because they were marginalized, it's because they're excluded, but the same victimhood narrative is actually used by Daesh to rally these youth. Right. So they come to you and say, okay, because you're marginalized and because you're excluded, then we provide you an alternative space. That's one example, but I wanted to go back to power. I think if we will not shift power, we will not have inclusion. And many people here, if it's teacher, student, if it's, you know, who decides in the room, who speaks, who decides this, who is on this space, who decides the past couple of days who's on the stage, and you could see the diversity, then that's where power lies. And I think another power that we have as citizens, and probably we're not taking up on it to do action, I lived under dictatorship for 23 years, and I was thinking that the only power is the one dictator, the one ruling party, but even the police institution for me was power, because in Tunisian dialect we say, for police, the ruler, hakim.
The police, the ruler.
The meaning of literally the meaning of the word is ruler, so I don't engage in that space because I think that's a power space, and it's until the last maybe 2 years that I started to actually talk to police because I ran away from that kind of power. But I think once I started to do activism, then I realized I have actually power, and people have power, and I can rally that power to change policy. So we focus too much on like the leadership having power, and it doesn't mean that we are engaging in social movements that we're not political. The end game is to shift that kind of power from having it to the, you know, people that we actually pay them to serve us, to have the power back, as you said, to the people. But fundamentally, I think we should not have a discussion about inclusion without having power. We can have our individual stories and we can have our individual situations, but those are part of a bigger construction of oppression that we need to just break it. So it goes down to people being able to be inclusive.
Okay, yes. Thank you. I want to come back in particular to activism a little bit.
I'll add to what Laura said. So, well, for me, it was always very hard. Maybe it can be the extreme or unique case, but the thing was that where I come from, it was, you know, you don't see girls out there like this or dressing up like this or short hair. going to schools, things like that. But then coming to the city then, when people came to know about me that I was a girl, then it became even harder. And nobody want to train with me, play sports with me, talk to me. And then even if I want to be with the girls, they were also curious, like they haven't seen anyone like this, right? But I came to Canada, so everyone was used to of this. Everyone looked like, you know, there's a diversity, you know, their ears are used to of this kind of talks, their eyes are used to of people looking like this, but our people were not used to of this. But I think things kind of change with time, and when you especially with media or with the technology, that we are more connected and we get to hear about such things and see more people. So now I feel that I'm more accepted now in Pakistan than before when I was first and everybody was just, I was left out alone, no friends.
One more question.
Yes.
Hi, my name's Sam. To carry on from what you said then, I think it boils down to identity in and of itself, and then the expression of that identity is two completely different things. And I think with the generational example, whether it's natural or not, social media really plays into that, because as the younger generation, we've grown up with a lot more ingrained acceptance into not just someone's identity, but the whole expression of the identity and everything that goes along with it. So I think a good example is if you look at, in the UK right now, we've had a record number of LGBT people elected into Westminster, but those people, this isn't to say that every LGBT person should or would act a certain way, but the structures that define the political environment would mean they couldn't act to express a sexual identity in that environment, whether they wanted to or not. And I think that really plays into the idea that without real visibility of identity throughout society, then it's never really going to change.
Sam, can you give me an example of a narrative that had a positive impact in this regard in the UK? Because we've been talking a little bit about how narratives can be forces of inclusion. A mainstreaming of something that was previously on the outside. I'm looking for examples from other countries because of the same forces in play. Think about it. We'll come back to it.
Sure. You've got some very hard answers over here.
All right. But we'll come back. If something comes to you, we'll come back.
Okay.
To you.
Well, I think, first of all, in Mexico, we have a sociologist, and he was studying indigenous reactions, and he made this, well, he identified this term, which is internalized colonization. So
internalized colonization. Okay.
So what happened is that, and I see it a lot, I'm a professor, I'm a teacher, and I see it a lot when I have indigenous students, and they themselves exclude themselves out, and they have not, because it's so internalized. It's, as they said in the previous one, it's a social construct. Race, gender, everything is a social construct, that it's a lie said so many times that you believe it's true. And so you're fearless of, because I guess nobody ever wants to feel embarrassed or ashamed. So in giving that first step towards an environment that, which is very symbolic power to white male, it's very important. And as for narratives, I'm working in a project that's called There Is Women in Mexico. And so what we do is, it's a lot of women get together in different areas, and we had a table full of like really amazing women. And to my surprise, the president that was presiding that sat on the, you know, head of the table. And the person that was doing the narrative was a man. And at that moment, I said, please, you cannot write as a male the stories that women are telling. You cannot do that, because the way you translate what you hear has already that understanding of reality so differently. So to me, it'd be, I would like to see a 6 degrees in indigenous camps. I would like to see a 6 degrees directly in refugees, you know, like having new people who actually have the story to tell it and hear that from them, and not from what we think that they're feeling.
Please. Oh, sorry. Sorry, Marty. Yes.
Yeah, you wanted to...
Yes, sir.
Charlie, you wanted a specific example.
Yes.
I go back to being schooled in England. I was born in Bombay, being schooled in England in 1954, and my grandfather came to visit us in London in 56. He came to visit my school. I had declined to go to the morning service, which was a Protestant service every morning.
Right.
And I thought, I'm a Jain, why should I go to a service? I was excluding myself. I was summoned to the headmaster's office by my grandfather and the headmaster, and he said, your grandfather can't understand why you don't go to the church service. It's a Christian service in the morning.
What do you lose by going to that? And I have to say that from 56 onwards, it changed my whole approach to living in the UK and living with other people. It was one catalytic input, and it was just broaden one's mind and say, why am I being stupid?
Right.
So that's what I want to say. This is an example I want
to do. Right. Yes. Hi.
Hi. My name is Danny. I'm from the United States. In 2008, candidate Barack Obama did not support gay marriage. It was considered to do so was considered a fringe, extreme position. And 6 years later, gay marriage became legal, and it was widely supported by the public. The reason for that was that the storytellers in our country, based in Hollywood, for example, with narratives like the movie Brokeback Mountain, showed people what it was like to be homosexual, essentially. It was that they understood that it wasn't just this kind of odd... disposition they couldn't understand, and the reason was that people in who had that power of narrative were gay or lesbian,
yeah.
And so the challenge, in gender and racial inclusion is that there's no closeted indigenous people. In CEO positions, or
right? Who can? Well, I'm very interested.
I'd
like to let Alexander come back.
Well, I'll just say that as a film and television producer, I'll say that I think Will and Grace is responsible for marriage equality in America. Yeah,
Marty, I'm gonna let Alexander address just that very notion, then we'll come to you, and then to you, ma'am. Yes.
No, I think it's a great point by Danny. I would just say though that again to my point around sort of the limits of narrative, there was also a decade of HIV activists that lost their lives in the 80s and into the 90s when it was stigmatized, and that also played a big role. So I agree storytelling is important and dialogue is important, but there's a lot of people who put their lives on the line or lost their lives, and that also shifted that conversation.
Yeah. Yeah. Great, I'm Thais Cadalara. I'm a journalist from Argentina, and I hear a lot about what media should do or not. Last year in Argentina, every 29 hours, a woman was killed mostly by her couple, husband, and it was a group of journalists who decided to start saying Ni Una Menos. I don't know if you hear about the movement, but then was internationally. Basically, it was like, stop, they are killing us. And I think that sometimes all the discussion that we have here is also not about, okay, what politicians can do or what are the policies that we need, but what can each of us do from each profession. For example, when I write that article, I see something that could be like stupid, but okay, how many men or women I have as a source? I mean, I am doing inclusion. How many young people also I am interview, or is always about like expert or something? And even the last thing, I am specialized in climate change, and I have been the climate negotiations that old white men are designing our future. It's like you have the event, the day for youth, the day for women, but we are not in the table making the decisions. So I think that it's not only about what we discuss here, but how we can participate when we need like to make the decisions. Thank you.
Yes. And I know there's down here, Marty, and then...
No, I think up there and then down
here. Man over here who wants to speak.
Thank you. Yesterday we heard the organizer of the Women's March talk about intersectionality, and you just pointed out that... power is a very important notion, how we can change society. And I feel like in the last 3 days, as well as today, we have been tiptoeing around economic power and how economic power affects a lot of what we do in society. So we talk, for example, about old white men, and I think rich old white men. And if you want to change, for example, how indigenous populations are treated in society, I hear about, you know, schooling, I hear about, you know, being aware of it, and that's all great. What I don't hear is how you actually want to give them back their dignity by giving back their land, by giving them back, you know, control of enormous companies, which are controlled by, of course, rich white men, or I would say rich white families primarily.
Rich white mafias.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Would have been a nice for you. Yeah.
We'll swing back around to that, I'm guessing. Yes.
Okay, hi, my name is Mombi. I'm from Kenya and I'm a student here. So I was just thinking about the narrative. So I have two examples. One is when I was a child. So in Kenya, we have many ethnic communities, and mine is a majority. And my parents' generation, and to some degree ours, is quite still ethnically biased, although ours is doing better, I think. And I remember once coming from school, and I was always talking about this girl who was my friend called Lynette. And I was always talking about Lynette. And my mom one day just asked me, but what's her surname? And I was like, why did you ask me that? You know, because when you say the surname, you'll know. So I think, and my mom always talks about that, because that's a time when she realized her own bias. That's one example. I think literature is also really important. One example is Chimamanda Adichie's book, Americana, because I think that is an excellent book that shows the diversity of minority communities. That, so as an African immigrant, you know, you are going not always out of necessity, but out of choice. And it's those different stories that sometimes help people to have more deep conversations, rather than just focusing, oh, you're from Africa, you know, safari and animals. And yeah, I mean, we love them, but you know, there's more.
Yes, one more, I think. Anyways, you're meant to throw it, I think. Yeah. Oh, no, there we are. Oh, yes. Hi, how are you doing?
Hi, I'm fine, thank you.
Could you identify yourself? People should know who you are.
Okay. My name is Boholo Ginoendo, and I'm from Botswana. I am the Minister of Trade and Investment, but I am not speaking as the minister. But, you know, I think it's the interesting point of views that have been aired to this point. But I am really hesitant in accepting the issue of internalized colonization, because we were not colonized by choice. And you still have to deal with these issues of your name is too difficult when people are unable to pronounce Djokovic. Why is Ginoendo so hard for you to pronounce? You know, and that's not internalized colonization. Because we are out here, we're working. I studied in the UK. And still, there were issues. I'm out there putting myself out, but there's still issues. Is that internalized colonization? It's not. And when we are changing the narratives, it's about really starting to just accept that another person who might look different from you is as special as you think you are. And we all have our challenges, and we are all trying to attain something. And inclusion is mainly stopped by the idea that it's always about survival of the fittest. That's just what it is. Because we're all looking for those jobs, and we think you're coming from a different space, so you don't deserve the job in my area. Or that you're studying, you got a scholarship and I didn't, when this is my country. So those are the issues that we need to address. We need to address issues of, why do you look different? Why do you still draw black people as monkeys? Why do you still throw bananas at black people? At the best athletes who are proving themselves and working to be included in different spaces. So I don't believe entirely in that idea of internalized colonization. I'm sorry, it got me really it got me really emotional, because we have a lot of we have a lot of young kids in these spaces that are trying really hard, that are working hard, to be included. They are doing their best at schools that are not giving them the best teachers.
Definitely.
They are doing their best at finding jobs. But because my application is written Boholo Kenwendo and yours is Anna something, I don't get called to an interview.
Yes.
So if in those kind of spaces, if you hold some sort of power, and it's not always white rich men, it can also be, surprisingly, people who come from maybe a marginalized part of society. I had friends in Los Angeles, and I'm wrapping up. I had friends, I had friends in Los Angeles when I studied there who were from a Jewish community. Grandmother had a mark, okay? And yet, the dad in that family didn't think I was good enough to be sitting at the dinner table. So if you have experienced that kind of discrimination and hurt, then why do you still want to perpetuate that?
Yeah.
And I think those are the kind of issues that we have to deal with. If you've lived it, don't perpetuate it. If you haven't lived it, recognize your privilege.
Yes.
And open up spaces for other people.
Yeah. Yes, I completely respect what you're saying, and I think what I meant to say is this is also another part of it. I'm not saying that everything has to do with internalized colonization, because it's part of the problem. I mean, and I say it because of from my reality, from what I see. I have students that yes, I agree that from the moment, and that's what I'm saying. Nobody has even, like, if somebody just went inside the door right now and we were all looking this way, and we didn't even know who's entering, that person, if they see majority of white people, would feel like, holy shit, I'm going in here, you know? Like, it's like that moment of recognizing what you're going to go through, and I'm sorry, I don't know if I shouldn't use language, sorry. Like, what you're going to go through, and even if that other person, the others around, haven't even acknowledged that, and then when they turn around, yes, I agree. Like, it's very different, that moment. But then also, for example, those that perpetuate it have also had that moment of, since I think that's also, maybe, I don't know, psychology, I don't know why, but you've been relegated and excluded so long that in the moments that power is received, it is understood that there is different types of power, because you can do power for, power with, but we understand power as power over. Most of the power that we seek in societies are power over. And that is a great issue, because once someone gains power, instead of doing power to change, they use power over to feel that they're not excluded anymore. And I think that's what perpetuates what you're saying. I didn't mean to disrespect other things, thinking or anything, but I do think it's also a part of a problem, at least in Mexico, in indigenous people who feel excluded, but like even before. Yes.
Thank you.
I would just say a brief thing. I think absolutely agree with what you said. I think what we internalize is powerlessness, that we cannot change that situation, or that we cannot, you know, crack the system. But I think just for also diversity of voices, I'm going to put you on the spot, and I want to give you my talking time.
Yes.
Yasmin.
Over to Yasmin. Everyone gets a lifeline. Everyone on stage gets a lifeline. I forgot to mention that.
Fine.
In 60 seconds.
I mean, like, I'll say a couple of things in 60 seconds. I'll say the first is that, like, you know, I can be in this room and be someone who offers provocative points or perspectives, but that is partly because I've been in hundreds of rooms like this where people say 100 things and it really has no difference at all, right? Because the guy that was on stage earlier, that's a chairman of a big, huge, enormous engineering company, was my big boss. And my personal experience at that company was the complete opposite of what this guy talks about, right? And there are so many stories that we can, that, like, I'm sure every person in this room can probably think of a personal experience or somebody they know or something like that, where the rhetoric is just completely different from the lived reality. And it's so exhausting. Oh my God, I cannot tell you how exhausting it is to be someone who just wants to be a bloody engineer. But no, I can't just be a bloody engineer. I have to be an advocate for my race and my gender and my religion and my everything, as well as being a damn good engineer and being the best one, because if I'm mediocre, then I'm representing my entire group. If I'm bad as an engineer, do you think they say Yasmin is bad? No, they say all women. They say all black people. They say all Muslims. Every single damn day of my life, I was 10 when September 11 happened, and I went from being someone who was just brown to the face of all evil. When was the last time you saw a positive story about Muslim people on the television? How do you expect that we are going to have an inclusive community when every single damn representation of an entire faith in the Western world is one about terrorism, about oppression? God damn it. Like, and I have to sit here in this room and be the one that says it. So not only do I have to exist in the world as someone who takes on this extra burden, as someone who can no longer live in the country that I am the citizen of, because I spoke out and there was a concerted media character assassination, a concerted character assassination by my federal government. When I lost my job, the immigration minister said one down, many to go. Okay? So you talk to me about citizenship. You talk to me about inclusion. I was the model minority, and that wasn't worth shit. So I am tired. I just turned 27 and I am exhausted of hearing people be like, yo, it's so hard, and then go live their really comfortable lives. Because even me saying this is accepting the fact that my life, my entire life, is going to be difficult, because I can no longer just have a normal engineering job. Any damn rig I go onto, they will know who I am, they will treat me accordingly. I recently got refused entry into the United States because of where I was born. And the irony, of course, was I was speaking at an event called No Country for Young Muslim Women. So please, the things that we're talking about aren't abstract. They're my lived experience, right? And we can kind of be like, I guess we have, many of us in this room have the privilege of just going home, going to sleep, ordering dinner from Amazon Prime in some cases, and not having to experience it. But this stuff matters. This stuff destroys people's lives. This stuff is about history, because it's bloody hard to just simply say, you know, pull yourselves up by your bootstraps, when there was a systematic, concerted campaign by colonizers over hundreds and hundreds of years to destroy people so that they would not be able to pick themselves up by their bootstraps. So they didn't even have bootstraps to pick themselves up by. And you know the best part? Is that I come into spaces like this and I'm expected to be grateful. I'm expected to be grateful for the fact that I have a voice or a podium. And that was the biggest narrative around me in Australia. You should be grateful we let you in and contribute. You should be grateful that you got this education. I would be grateful if the English hadn't come into my country, destroyed it, and then required me to leave so that I could have some sort of semblance of a life. Because still, the narrative that exists, and I know this is more than 60 seconds, is one where we look at certain parts of the world and we don't see them as human beings with agency. We don't see people in Africa as human beings with agency. No, we see them as perhaps assets. We see them as people who just need to survive. We don't see them as people who might have great art to contribute. We don't see them as Silicon Valley leaders, AI experts. No, we see them as people that we need to feed, maybe clothe. So when we give those who aren't privileged in our society the same level of agency, truly, as we give ourselves, perhaps we'll see some change. But until then, I'm just gonna, I suppose, try to continue to survive and try to continue to be as provocative as possible, because somebody's gotta do it. And the good thing, the one thing I am grateful for, is that at least, inshallah, I won't get killed for it. Thanks.
is the issue on some level that many people are not willing to give anything up?
That's an odd way to go. What do you mean by that?
Adrienne, I think all the time about these conversations as well, obviously not from nearly so real and authentic a place as you do. But I think all the time about that the conversation at some point has to be about what are we willing to give up to better share what is available.
But we're not talking about scarcity. Not when we talk here about human relationships, when we talk about creating legal spaces, when we talk about changing existing legislation, we're not talking about giving up. We're talking about progressing. We're talking about making things work that we perhaps didn't have the right intentions for before with things. I don't think we're talking...
You don't think so?
No.
Anybody agree or disagree with that? Okay, we have a couple of people. Anybody on stage before we go back up? How are we doing on time, Aisha?
15 minutes.
All right.
And I just, yeah, just yes, to continue please. With that, I think that that puts you into that false dichotomy always of, you know, when immigrants come, they take away something from us. There's only a certain little pie, and that nobody thinks that little pie has yeast in it, and that little pie can grow bigger. You know, that it's not about just a little pie, and it's not about cutting up a piece of territory. It's about a kind of non-spatial, non-dimensional thing which has to do with, you know, the spiritual, the emotional, the dimensions of human life that are not just about territory or about that kind of thing. It's about the way in which you can expand, not about the way in which you have to cut off a piece of yourself to give it.
Maybe just giving up power. Maybe I'm thinking about power. And Aya, and then Alexander, yeah. And then we'll go out again. Anyway, choose three or four, Scott.
A lot of dudes with their hands up. Any dudettes?
Right. Aya, please.
Okay, so I'll make it brief. I would like people to contribute, but I just first want to acknowledge, thank you for sharing your story, and thank you for sharing with this group. I think after hearing that, only a conversation about social justice has to follow. And maybe one of the other examples of narratives, I know you've not been really into the power of narrative, but I think narrative is about information and the power of information. And whenever I come to Europe, I hear this crisis of refugees, for example, narrative.
Right.
So the last time I worked with the World Refugee Council, and the last time we went to Germany, and the whole conversation wasn't about crisis of leadership, but refugees. When some people who were had experiences in Africa were sharing, and the audience didn't realize that if you look at the largest refugee camp, is actually in Kenya, is not in Germany. If you look at the largest refugee population, it's in Jordan. If you look at the largest displacement, it's happening in Africa, and these countries have been hosting refugees for decades with little infrastructure, cannot even provide for their own citizens, and yet they've been welcoming to other refugees. Mm-hmm. So I just think that narrative is very powerful when people do not have the information, and that could be used to many of the manipulation of discussion on inclusion in the continent and in Europe. And I think the only way for us as activists is to hold people accountable for social justice. And I think lived experiences like Yasmin is something that is a daily reality that you live, and you have to justify your gender and your faith and all of that. But then what is missing is transnational solidarity. We talk about all this technology, but how much are we really in solidarity with each other? And what are the countries that are in solidarity with others? And when some events happen, what kind of political action we take as citizens? And I think we need to, we have such a power of transnational solidarity that we're not using. And the only thing that we can get out of this space, at least, is to stand in solidarity the next time you hear me arrested or Yasmin arrested, and you do some action. Even though we say everyone goes back and do their little things, but I think you have to still be connected to people who are here, who don't have a support system, and who go back to live under dictatorships and under repressive regimes and under racism. I just feel that the power of solidarity is always underestimated, and we need to start really being solidarity with each other, not by putting a Facebook picture holding hands, but by actually standing up for other people, elevating their voices, and doing the right thing.
Alexander, and then I think we have time for a few more.
Yeah, I'll keep this brief because I know there's a lot of hands in the room. I would just building on that, I think we often say, you know, rising tide lifts all boats, and I think it's an easy way of saying, oh, well, we're all in this together. We all believe in inclusion. We all believe in diversity. That's wonderful, but that doesn't change the realities for incredible individuals like yourself and Yasmin and others in this room. Their reality stays the same. And so I think when we talk about these things, we really need to acknowledge the fact that there's, even in this room, there's 5 seats on the stage. So that means 5 people are here, right? And so I think we really need to get to what are we actually going to do to give up power, because I think power is still a finite resource. So what are we going to do to actually give up some of that power and elevate some of those voices to actually really move on some of these issues?
And just yes, please. Very quickly to build on that, I always tell Canadians, non-Indigenous Canadians, who say, what can I do as a white Canadian? How can I help Indigenous people? And I say, go to them and listen and shut up. Shut up and listen. That has been life-changing for me, to just sit and be quiet and shut my mouth and let them tell their story. And after the first time I heard an elder tell me their story, they said, by your listening, you give empowerment. And that spoke volumes to me, to keep shutting up, to keep being quiet and letting the Indigenous voice speak, that they to make sure that the Indigenous voice is put on platform as much as possible. And I'm still meeting my parents' friends who have a lot of racist attitudes within Canada, even though it's after the TRC has finished. And they said, oh, well, the TRC has concluded, so we're done. And they still have negative stigma towards this group of people. They've never met an Indigenous person in their life. So meet these people, listen to them, and shut up.
But there are 57 recommendations of the TRC that we should just implement. When I'm saying, you know, what about giving up power? What I'm saying is that we have the power within us as a democratic society. I'm speaking specifically about our own society. That if we abolish the Indian Act, we have the perfect, we can do that if we want to. We can implement all the recommendations. We have that power. We don't have to say, you know, what else can we do? We already are doing these things. Let's do them, actually, not just say we have them on the books. We can do them. And therefore, I think by that, if we implement our treaties also and say to everybody, all white people, all the other people who are not Indigenous, you are treaty people. It isn't just the Aboriginal people who've signed treaties. You signed those treaties. Our ancestors signed those treaties. And even if you're a new Canadian citizen, you accepted all of that by being adopted in the Canadian family. You accepted all of the things that we did wrong. And they did many, many things wrong, and now we can make it right. That's all. It's a process.
Do we have time for how many? I need 3 minutes with our on in-circle people at the end. So we have maybe 3 interventions of 1 minute max each, please. I know this young fellow's been waving his hands for a while, but... Yes.
Two here.
Okay, great. That's it.
Hi. Just in terms of moving towards action from our discussion here, I was wondering if there were any thoughts about how this initiative can perhaps then also support the St. Gallen Symposium in becoming a little bit more inclusive and for more representative of the diversity of work that is happening in these areas.
Thank you. Oh, Marty, sorry. Yep. Yeah, back around. Yes. Hey. So... Yeah, you go first, please. You're closer. You have a microphone.
Right. So I think that this conversation, in a way, really is about scarcity. We talked about how, whether humans naturally strive for inclusiveness or exclusive, and really what we know from psychology and anthropology is that in situations of scarcity, we tend to exclude because we see it as a competition. We see things as not having, we see that there being finite resources. And when we, in my home state of Indiana, my relatives in rural areas voted for Trump because they, you know, these predominantly white people, they are hearing, you know, from the media, all they hear is, you know, shut up, just listen. And they're saying, well, where do I even have a voice to begin with?
Right.
They're suffering from, their friends are dying from addiction to opioids that have been, you know, based on the profits of pharmaceutical companies that are exploiting them. And they say, you know, that they, then when they hear that, you know, you're so privileged, you need to, like, make space for these immigrants, they say, there's nothing, can you blame them for saying, like, well, what about us? What is there, we don't have anything to give. What privilege do we have? And I think that there are, at least I can speak for those people in the U.S., they're really hurting and often get overlooked in the conversation.
Thank you. Last one, maybe, and then I will wrap it up. Oh, am I in the wrong spot? Alexander, do you want to speak?
Oh, no, just flagging that the individual in the... Sorry, I don't know. What was your name?
Sam.
Yeah.
So, yeah, he was asked earlier about something and then didn't get a microphone. So I just want to make sure he has...
Did you think of an example that you wanted to share, Sam?
I did, but if I could just say something else instead of that, that's a bit more...
All right, then. 30 seconds. Are you seating? All right, fantastic.
I'll make it really, really quick. But you were talking... I'll make it really quick, but you, like you just said, with the finite resources and scarcity, and you were talking about the small pie that can grow, the people aren't able to actually change anything. If you know, a rising tide lifts all boats, if everyone has a boat, right? If you don't have a boat, then you are in the water and you don't rise. You can't generalize these ideas to saying something like, oh, you know, a higher level. Kind of order of consciousness that allows us to be more diverse and more accepting. When you have people who, communities have nothing else to give to people. They have nothing even to propagate their own worth in the world. Like, what has to come first is restructuring and redistribution. That is the only thing that can ever really facilitate true diversity. Because you know, there's no other way to do it. You can't even help yourself first.
Thank you. Marty. Oh, yes, we're going to finish. Okay, please.
As you like.
All right, go ahead. All right. If I could ask you, please, 30 seconds.
Okay. The question of pie. I think it is very much a pie, not a small pie, a really big pie. And, you know, a very small number of people are eating a very large amount of pie. Right? Okay. The problem really is that these 1% that eat most of the pie tell the rest of the people who are eating less pie that, hey, please share a pie with the immigrants, with the refugees, but they're not really sharing their own pie, right? Somebody on the stage on the symposium said, learn to have less. Learn to have less. That's very interesting. He's not asking. Nobody's going to beg you to have less. You will have less, right? It will change. You will have less. Nobody's going to come and beg you, please, can we also take some? No, it'll be taken. Unless you learn to empathize truly, not for a favor. That's all.
Thank you. Yes.
Yeah. So my name is Jessica, I'm from the Netherlands, and as you probably know, the Netherlands has a horrendous colonial past. And the fact that I've had many opportunities is in many ways a direct consequence of that. And I think that a lot of people find it hard to acknowledge because it's something that happened in the past that we were not personally involved in. But even today, our countries are producing technologies that are exported to be used in war. Our pension funds are investing in weapons, and our governments are making deals with oppressive regimes. So we're talking a lot about narratives about, you know, solving things in the past, but we're still very much contributing to the problems today.
Thank you. I'm afraid I just want to end on stage, but there'll be many more time. I want you to know in advance that our final hour will be all about this very conversation. It's so far from finished. Marty's going to lead us through a conversation, in a sense, about what are we willing to give up? How are we willing to change? And who are maybe the we? But I asked the four guests before to give me a word, and I'd like to end with this, because Six Degrees is very interested in developing a kind of dictionary where we take words that are terms that are, the definition is a real problem because they're bad definitions, or the words themselves are bad. And I'd like to give each of you to, I asked you each to give me a word that advances positive notions of inclusion and a word that blocks them. So you have to come up with two words. Did you do your thinking over the last 90 minutes? She gets to go first.
I have two for each. Okay. So I guess I'll start with the bad first. I would say the two words that don't help to facilitate the sense of inclusion would be isolation and silence. Every Indigenous residential school survivor that I spoke with said it was silence that kept me locked in this prison, that I had so much shame that I felt the government had kept on me, and it wasn't until I spoke out that I could break that. And then for the good words, I would say it would be interaction and listening, especially if you are a non-Native person, if you're a white person with a place of privilege, as I am, to use your platform to make sure that the people who are in vulnerable communities have a voice, to listen, to be quiet, and to seek them out, and to hear them, to hear their stories, and listen.
Thank you. Alexander, you ready?
Sure. So, bad word to be provocative, because this is Six Degrees, and because words can never be disassociated from the context in which they're in, I would say inclusion itself. And because I think inclusion has come to be the pursuit of symbolic gestures that placate rather than disrupt, an affirmation of the value of inclusion and diversity by those that continue to benefit from the status quo remaining unchanged, and a framing of meaningful action coming at the cost of something else. So I just, those are some of the things that come to mind for me when I think of inclusion. That's sort of where the word has moved for me, is into this very symbolic realm. And for a good word, I would actually say nothing. And the reason being is I think for those of us that are in positions of privilege, we are on a mountainside in Switzerland with beautiful flowers outside the window, it's time for us to listen. In Canada, I say often, you know, we've talked for 150 years, and now it's time for others to come to the table and have their voices heard. So I would say nothing, and to give that space to others.
Aya?
On the positive, I would say voice, because I think our struggle, especially for this generation, is a struggle for voice. And not only listening, I think talk to us and not about us. That's even more important. And space, I think creating spaces. I'm not interested, I mean, I lead a movement that has members in 40 countries in Africa, and I'm not interested to fight Daesh with weapons. I leave Daesh alone, do its own thing, and I create spaces that are empowering, that are non-violent, that are non-misogynist, non-discriminatory, and those, and even we say in the movement, we radicalize youth into social change, so it's as aggressive as what other people are doing violently. And then negative, I think there are so many problematic words not to say, but I would think more of a system. I think the system of oppression, of all sorts of oppression, whether it's dictatorship or patriarchy or whatever it is hindering a discussion about inclusion.
So system, the actual...
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Systems of oppression.
Adrienne.
I think my most positive word would be acceptance. And I think acceptance is something that is not a passive thing, and it doesn't imply acceptance of you know, bad things or whatever. But acceptance is something which is a stance. And I think it can cover all kinds of things that people are trying to talk about when they don't want to use words like tolerance or other things like that. Acceptance is that big thing, which is being able to take it all in. My negative word is no.
No.
I think no is really a no-no. And I think no is not the right thing. And you must not bring up children for that by saying to them no, ever. That was one of the rules I had as mother, I have to say. I don't say no. And I always have said that I say yes to life and no to individual things. And so I think that yes to life is acceptance,
right.
And the no is nothing, is a negation, and is brings you into nothingness.
It's been a real pleasure and an honor to host this session. I thank you all for your passion, your vulnerability, your intelligence, your patience, and I want you to join me in thanking Aya, Adrienne, Alexander, and Alicia for their
Thank you, Charlie. Thank you, everyone. So here's what, we're going to take a photo after, I think. Here's what we're going to do. We have 45 minutes now to go from anxiety to action. This is an opportunity to turn the concerns that have been raised all day, and if you want, over the course of the last few days in the St. Gallen Symposium, over which we have no control, but we'd love to participate in making it more diverse in the future, if that's what you want us to do. But this is an opportunity for us as a group to think back over the issues that have been shared and the concerns that have been raised, and to find a positive action for us as individuals. As Alexander said, you know, there's privilege and privilege. To be at one of the most esteemed business schools on the planet Earth in one of the most beautiful countrysides in the world with a group of outrageously dedicated, smart, and articulate people is a position of great privilege for all of us. And we created this room with a view to not putting people on stage, although I'm standing slightly above the rest of you. I spent most of the day standing with you, and we spent most of the day listening from you and less of the day listening to us. But now is a chance for us to actually create a plan together about how we can, point by point, address some of the challenges and opportunities that we've identified together. So if you think about a proposal that might be achievable, you are the leaders of either today or tomorrow. You are the people who are maybe activists now, will continue to be activists. Maybe you'll be politicians. Maybe you'll be start your own schools. This is where the rubber hits the road. This is our opportunity to establish an agenda for change. And so with that in mind, I'm going to start the conversation with really a kind of synthesis of what we've heard over the course of the day. And I'm going to invite Upkar to present a bit of a synthesis, which we can respond to or disagree with. And then we're going to come back to the room for, as I said, action items that we can take forward. Upkar.
Thanks, Marty. I will try to do a bit of a synthesis about the various topics that were discussed, and I think what we found today was an incredible wide range of topics and issues that were discussed, and as Charlie said, certainly no clear agenda of where the direction and the topics were going. So I took a couple notes as we were going, and let me maybe touch on a few key things that might help to frame the conversation about what action plan and what proposal might emanate from the follow-on discussion. So one of the things I heard clearly and loudly was that language is very important. And we started off with the concept of inclusivity, and people struggled with that concept as whether that was even the right word, inclusion, whether that was the right word. And so the first key item that I took away is that we need to be very conscious, very deliberate, very thoughtful about what language we use to define what terms. And when we say inclusion, who is that really including, and who is that really excluding, or does it force an exclusion? The second key thing I heard was that we can't talk about certain things like inclusion or citizenship without actually putting into the conversation in a very meaningful and deliberate way the whole concept of power and what the power structures are and how do we share or how do we give up or how do we do something related to the power structures that are underneath the systems that we either live by, either we uphold, we reinforce, or we actually proactively or passively somehow try to change in some way. So the the intermingling then of inclusion and power structures and the systems of power needs to be addressed and in a material way. The third thing I heard was that perception is really, really critical. We talk about both, in many ways, identity and expression of identity, but what the perception of identity is, what expression leads to people's perception, and that comes to the fore based on what we choose to call ourselves, how we interact with others, and what we bring to the table, both physically, both in terms of how we act and what we look like. So the aspect of perception was the third key thing. The next key thing, and I'm trying to frame it, Marty, just to three or four key things, was really about talking about, I'm just trying to think about the, I might just stay with those three as being three, unless, Marty, do you want me to solicit anybody else? Did anybody else feel any other theme was really, really prominent? We did talk about various actions, including the last series of actions about stopping, listening authentically and actively to people who aren't at the table or who have not had a voice at the table. But is there, Marty or anybody else, is there any key themes that came up that I think I may have missed? Because Marty, do you want to summarize three or?
Yeah, no, I think you've done a great job. I mean, I do think this notion of power to the people, which came up over and over again, particularly later in the day, was particularly compelling. So I do think now is the time to go back out to the audience and ask for specific interventions. You're the minister, you're the prime minister, you're the secretary of state. What's the first new change you want to introduce based on what you've heard today or what you haven't heard today? Who's first?
We have Victoria right here.
Good.
Hello, my name is Victoria. Stand up, okay. I'm a young, obviously, white, blonde girl. It's very easy for me to do anything, go anywhere I want. In high school, I had a friend from Ethiopia. Her name was Tamaj, one of my best friends. She transferred from the public high school to a Catholic high school, which I attended. And our religion teacher, we were taking world religions. And at the time, I was very naive, and I didn't see it, that he was blatantly racist. Sad that my parents, and now me, after turning 18, pay taxes to our Canadian government to pay a teacher who was teaching students how to be racist. I think we need to start right where it hits home. We need to filter our educators to educate the future. That should be our first plan, is to filter educators to educate future generations to be kind and accepting, and maybe we can change the future one by one in our classrooms with young students.
Marty, I've got some people over. Hello. Over here, we've got Riz. I'm going to put Jason on the spot as well. But let's start over here.
Thanks. So I'm just thinking also about how education is given, so in terms of history, and I think that's more useful for most European countries, because I find, you know, the stories or how you learn about things like colonialism, you know, you talk about the language again, pacification of the native population, you know, millions died through that. One of the ways is to educate people about what happened so that by the time you see somebody who is coming from Africa, wherever it is, you kind of have an idea of the past, you know? And then at the individual level, I do think it's important to listen. And I also think it's important to be ready to be uncomfortable. So the way we said that, you know, you ask someone to dance, maybe you fall down, you know? Maybe you step on their toes, maybe they step on your toes, but it's having those difficult conversations and the authentic ones. That's really hard, but you have to do it. We all have to.
Thank you. Well, I just wherever we're going, I just wanted to highlight that it's interesting, our first two comments are about education and about educators, and here we are at a university, which is not young, old, which has been educating forever. And so if in your comments there's something that, and of course this is a university that is educating business leaders of tomorrow, we were at great lengths over the course of the day to identify that diversity, which is a fact, not a choice, but it is actually happening. Our societies are becoming more diverse. We made the business case that this is actually positive for shareholder value and for social value. And nevertheless, we continue to have this conversation in the context of this business school. So I'd like to, maybe if there are comments related to the manner in which business can be differently taught at this school and elsewhere, that'd be helpful too.
Okay, it's Riz Khan again. Thank you, actually, that's a perfect lead-in because I must say, it's just one of those things, if we look around, the whole world is pretty much in this room. I'm used to holding a microphone like this. Yeah, it's like very, maybe I won't send these to the BBC and CNN.
You're meant to be uncomfortable here.
Sorry?
You're meant to be uncomfortable.
Yeah, I am a little bit uncomfortable because the trouble is, you know, it's like we're talking to the converted. We wouldn't be in this room if we didn't have an acceptance of the need for change, if we didn't actually sit in such a diverse crowd. It's already here. But the sad part is, as a journalist, you know, we cover stories of so many things where people, it's people talking to the converted, and we seem to miss out the people who need to be in the room, in the conversation. In terms of the business school, one of the key things is, you know, it was brought up in by Philip Jennings of the labor groups, the unions. He said, get rid of shareholder value. It's become the most corrupt phrase on the planet. It's totally corrupt because who are the shareholders mostly? They're not the people who get something out of it personally. It's an increase of the wealth of the really wealthy, the exclusivity of those who need to be looked after. I mean, one of the first things we should start doing, let people make tons of money. If they start businesses and so on, but stop, I mean, I'm sorry, I know there's bankers in this room, but stop paying bankers a fortune for screwing up banking. Let business make tons of money, but education is the key, and let those people being educated know that if they make that much money, they have the power to do something different. Let's start calling up billionaires from today and saying, do something good with your money, you don't need another yacht, you know?
Hi, thank you. So I think what we're really hearing in the room, and I don't want to be, you know, not everybody can be a prime minister, one person can be a prime minister, but each and every one of us can recognize that actually inclusion is not a fuzzy feeling about us holding hands, it is painful. It is about redistribution, it is about challenging your identity and what you hold dear. And really, you know, privilege is blind. And I think that if you're accustomed to privilege, equality feels like discrimination. And so my challenge to all of you is get comfortable with being uncomfortable because we need to start there. Thank you.
Promise, this will be the last. all right. I come from the development sector, and the development sector seems to be like a dark, shady, murky place of governments, corporates, and non-profits. But the worst thing I've see and feel about it is this sort of need for us to tell people who are actually on the ground, who are living the marginalization, what they should do to improve their lives. It's absolute nonsense. I mean, just ask, you know, that's I'm just sick and tired of really rich people telling poor people how they should, you know, get better, work hard and, you know, live a beautiful life. They can, just stop meddling, yeah, that's all. Thank you.
Okay. Is it me?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So I know one phrase that we've sort of been throwing around a lot is how about we get voices on the table, and I think we should actually like take that like as a practical thing, actually get voices to the table. So I was recently at an African Development Conference, and I was at a panel on women's empowerment, And one of the ministers of finance there was speaking about a recent policy that they had implemented. And they were going to send a few delegations to New York where they were going to be discussing women's empowerment, particularly for women in rural areas. And they had instituted a policy that said for every delegate that was going to be going to New York, they were required to bring a woman from a rural community with them to join them at that delegation where they're going to be discussing women's empowerment. And I think like something practical like that, and the phrase that was used over and over again during that conference was, nothing about us without us. And I think if we can take that very seriously, I think we can actually start seeing more voices at the table. And then, so that's kind of like at a more like large scale, but like I think even at a smaller scale, you know, I've been in several just like random meetings where, you know, a woman or even myself as a person of color say something and it's, you know, it's not acknowledged immediately, and then someone else says the exact same thing that I just said. And then all of a sudden, wow, brilliant idea. You know, thank you for your contribution. So I think even in moments like that, how do you make sure that even in a small way that people's voices at whatever table you're in are like genuinely being recognized as valuable and just as important as anyone else's on the table?
Great. Thank you.
So I suppose I'll elaborate a little bit on the comment I made previously. You encouraged some specific suggestions for the University of St. Gallen and perhaps the business school. So I think one very interesting example might be to think a little bit about the essay competition that I think some people in the room are part of. I didn't submit an essay, so I'm not fully aware of the process. But I thought it was interesting to see that on both days when we saw the finalists, of course, they were all men. We saw the finalists from the essay competition that was done for the symposium. This is the leaders of tomorrow. So I think on the first day, I'm not fully aware how we selected the ones on the first day, but we voted. Yes. Can I?
I was in the process, so actually, yeah. There was 42% women, I think, entered out of the 1,208 essays. It was 5-stage blind. We didn't think, as a judge, I didn't know who the winners were by name or anything. I just knew the essays. So it's actually, yeah. And we discussed it, and we all felt bad that it was guys.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think, and I'm aware that it was a blind competition, and so of course it's a tricky case. So. I wonder, but I did wonder if that was random, and I did wonder what the effect might be on young women studying business in the audience to feel that, you know, these are the leaders in our field.
Well, you've got the same about winning twice, which is worse.
Yeah, exactly. So I was just wondering how random that was and whether there could be some critical reflection on how that may have happened. And I also don't know if it's reflective of the various years.
Sorry, again, just quickly,
Yeah.
But they said it's a free and open contest.
They, sure.
It was totally random. As much as everyone felt guilty, it was totally random.
Yeah. Can I, if I could just finish real quickly my thought.
Yes, let her finish, please.
Thank you.
This is like a classic example of what happened.
This is a example of people talking together in a big room and taking turns.
Okay. So I don't necessarily have the answer. I guess I'm just wondering, you know, if it would be interesting to have some more critical reflection on perhaps how the question is phrased, what the institutes are that are being approached, and how we're evaluating language, both men and women, what kind of phrasing we understand as good writing, you know, and whether it might be an interesting case for us to think very critically about our own biases potentially.
One question I had for the panel, just the jury, is I don't know based on several things the winners won, but if you come from Germany or Australia or the US, you will have an easier time to write a beautifully written essay than if you come from Nigeria or Nepal or Colombia. So I wonder what are the criteria, but it's easier for somebody from an English-speaking country to win that contest, probably.
I don't think it's that so much because the because, again, the judges come around the world, and the judging done through stages involves a lot of people from around the world. If you notice the winners we've had in the past, we've had people from certainly non-English backgrounds. The thing I felt guilty about was doing the presenting voting, and I said that, because it's a bit unfair with the presenting. Some people are naturally good presenters, and I think it's embarrassing. But I would honestly, we all reflected on this, but it's totally, totally random. That's the weirdest thing.
I'm just going to, I'm going to use my host elbows again. I don't think we want to pick apart the essay competition in detail. There are opportunities to provide that feedback, and I think it is valid. However, there are other ways that we can look at inclusion as well. So it is completely legitimate, and I think there are real challenges to unpick here. Let's also look at other ways. This gentleman here has been waiting very, very patiently.
Hello, my name is Nicholas. I come from Greece, which is interesting because I'm 26 years old, and I've lived through a period of time when I was younger, everything was, for my country, in Europe at least, everyone was, yeah, you're nice, you have a nice food, we like feta, we like the islands. And then suddenly I was lazy, I didn't work, I was owning money, and I had friends in Germany living there for 10 years. Their landowners asked for advance in the rents despite having stable jobs in Germany because Greece was in trouble. And I want to say that after that, I went and worked with refugees in Greece, and I saw an underlining issue, an underlining problem in all of that inclusion discussion that we talk, and it's the dissemination of information and how people were afraid of what they did not know, they don't know, and how I saw in a different parts, in completely different regions, for completely different things, that people didn't know stuff that was available, but not really available. And my solution, my first thing that I would do if I was a prime minister, would be to rework how news are disseminated, how accessible it is for everyone to get nice and objective information. So, because our democracy is based on the assumption that we all have access to the same amount of information as markets in the capitalistic society are, that we have access to the same kind of information. And if we don't, we cannot hope for a democracy that works or inclusion that includes everyone. And the second point, and last, I also study here, so I guess I have an opinion about why does this business school operates like that and how can we make it a bit better. My main problem is all my teachers are white males and coming from Germany or Austria or Switzerland, and they, not that it's bad, there's an orthodoxy on how business should be done and should be conducted. And this, it's funny thing, I have a class called Corruption in Sub-Saharan Africa, but it's taught by professor who is a black coming from Africa, but it's so apparent that he's not included in the way that this school conducts the how they conduct business, how they teach the material. He doesn't know the loops that you have to go through in order to let everyone talk and write their essays and all that. And I see that we have this kind of orthodoxy going in this school, which creates an echo chamber between men, white men, coming from specific privileged region, that if it doesn't change, it won't be any kind of change on how this school, or any business school for that reason, can include more people and more opinions. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Lucas from Germany. And talking about inclusion, I think what we always forget is acknowledgement as well. And I can tell you like a short personal story. I did a buddy training, like a language exchange, with a Syrian refugee in Germany, and he was back home electrician. And he was really a good electrician. He did a lot of like big projects within his company. When he came to Germany, he spoke within 8 months like fluent German, what is quite impressive. as one side. And then he wanted to work and he wanted to do something to contribute to society because he was able to. And he was not allowed to do it because they didn't acknowledge his education. What he was able to do just because it's from Syria and it doesn't have like the same papers that we have here in Germany or wherever. And even the same happens in Europe. And that's like sometimes I feel that in Western countries, you believe that our education is the best and no one else can have like the same level. Whereas if you look, for example, to Iran, like they were much more progressive than a lot of countries in Europe, and now it's kind of like, oh, well, you come from this country, so your education is like whatever. And I think this acknowledgement is something that we have to take as well in companies, plus like in government and in education system for real, because it's excluding a lot of workforce that want to
really want to contribute, and in the end you stand there after 2 years of not being allowed to work with your skills and like asking yourself, what should I do in the society? I really want to, but they don't let me. And this, and then, well, it goes from there somewhere else.
Okay, hi, I'm Nicole, I'm from Canada, living in Montreal. No, the government didn't make us all be here today. On the point of, I think, just going back to one of the first points on shareholder, like redistribution of wealth, I think, especially coming out of, we're in the sort of the wake of the conference and talking a lot about artificial intelligence. And I think one thing that we completely kind of overlooked actually at the conference was the history of AI and the history of these ideas. And that, I mean, Switzerland has a really good history and an interesting one that's out of Lugano with Jürgen Schmidhuber. And what's really important about that, because essentially some of his codes in probably almost all of your phones, is that it started out of something that was non-proprietary. This is open source. And that's super important in terms of sharing ideas, collaborating on ideas, being able to have access to ideas. And so when we talk about redistribution and kind of also Nicholas's point about really sharing of information, like this, we can leverage technology to do it better, to do it faster, to make sure no matter where you are in the world, you have access to it in different ways. And I think that's just a really important point on collaboration also means changing the way that we actually look at what belongs to us. So whether it's shareholder value or propriety or even something like inheritance, really taking all of what we get and re-questioning why it comes to us in the first place. Thanks.
I have the mic. right, I think I agree with most of the points that have been put out, that we listen to other stories and we acknowledge those different points. And in addition to that, I'd like to encourage that if you are in a position of decision making, you take a moment to reflect on your next step. See, if you're a journalist, you take a moment to think about that story that you're going to write about the female astrobiologist. Because what you write about her will then have an impact on whether she continues working or not, and how many people get motivated and inspired to go into that field. It's the same as, I'll give you a quick example. There was a study, a story that was written about me when I joined Parliament. It said it was myself against a man. So for the gentleman, it was written, so-and-so eyes plans to conquer this constituency. And then for me, it was Genuendo plans to seduce. Right? So it is those narratives that you spread about those that are maybe marginalized that decides or determines whether they continue, how many people join that space or not. Right, what you decide to write, especially for journalists, how you decide to write about those groups that feel or that are traditionally excluded can have a great impact. And then the last part here is, after you listen, open the door. Open the door, because just listening and leaving is not going to change someone's life. If you just listen to that story that they, you know, they grew up in poverty, they still don't have anything to eat, and you say, I understand, it's because of our history, thank you very much, bye-bye. It's not going to change anyone's life. So if you are once again in that sieving process, you have an opportunity to call someone for an interview, do so. Don't make fun of people's names, because that has a great impact on whether or not you're going to call that person for an interview. And if you see it and it's written Chidinma Adicheke or whatever, and you call your colleagues and you start laughing at her name, you're not going to call her for an interview. So the next time you're put in that position, consider opening the door for that person based on their qualifications, of course, if they qualify, but don't just shut them out because they have a funny name. And the same applies for conferences. I am very aware of that UN conference. They said bring a woman from the rural area. You're going to bring her, you're going to take her to New York. It's going to be a cold experience for her. And she's going to go back to the reality of not having anything to eat. Because you've given her the exposure, but you haven't necessarily opened the door to opportunity. And I think what's very important, something that affects everyday life and livelihoods, is opening doors for real life impact. So for jobs, for income basis, for businesses, that's where it's really vital. And I can give examples of how, as a minister, I'm working on that. But then, you know, I might disclose some things that we're still working on. But what's important and what I have pledged to do is to go to the areas that my previous ministers didn't go to. Because those SMEs in the furthest places in my country also need the ear of a minister and needs for us to make policies that are relevant to those people and the very furthest corners of my country. So I encourage all of you to take responsibility to opening that door of opportunity and exposure. Thank you.
Three quick things. Number one, I'm not a journalist, but I spend a lot of time on social media. And I only talk about things that I do, and I realize now that that's pretty ridiculous. Because there's incredible people in this room, one of whom's sitting beside me, who's done some phenomenal things. And the people that follow me on social media are pretty similar to me. And they've had experiences like mine. So I think it's time that I can share those different stories of things that I've learned and also actively seek them out and share them on my platform so they can be disseminated in even a smaller way. So that's a tangible thing that I'm going to take away from this, and I encourage others to do the same. Second comment, I'm Canadian as well. I went to Queen's Commerce. For those who don't know, that's a very fancy, very expensive business school. We also talk a lot about being innovative. Well, it's been pretty clear through this conference, and I'm thankful for the conversations we've had about knowing that maybe the systems that we're living in right now aren't totally foolproof. Shareholder value, as discussed, is not the best way. Why is it in business school that we never talk about what's really deeply wrong with business? And ethics is kind of a throwaway class. That's how it felt to me as a student. So for those who are in decision-making powers in spaces that see themselves as business schools and try to be innovative and build, and really do build the leaders of tomorrow, I encourage you to have the courage to have different types of conversations that may be less popular. Third comment, when a system leads to an outcome that we're not thrilled with. So there's many potential examples of that, but one was raised today about the essay competition. Then perhaps it's an opportunity to also, it's always good to be revisiting and knowing it's good that we're upset about an outcome of something, but I'm very thankful for the space that's been given to consider. If we don't like an outcome, what can we do to change it? Thank you. Thank you.
So my name is Vivian. I'm also from Canada, Vancouver, Canada. I have a very short point to make about not only businesses, but also from my personal experience, public sector as well as many other sectors can adopt, and that's concrete. And I think it's valuing the different types of leadership, especially for women leaders. And that is something, maybe it's just from an Asian perspective, but from my culture background, we're not used to being very, very super outspoken and to really be in the public eye. And that's often seen as something very strange because in China, in our traditional cultures, everyone wants to conform. And that's part of the communist ideal too. But I think one thing I learned in the past year working in Asia is that many female leaders, if they you know, exist in the industries, many of them want to project a very, very strong, a masculine exterior. And I had this conversation with some few participants today as well, that people tend to dress more masculine or appear very aggressive and take on this sort of characteristic to make them feel very strong. But at the same time, many of the traditional feminine archetypes, which I don't like to use that word, but those sort of different types of leadership sometimes it's not as valued. And especially I think that is a barrier for female leaders, because if one is strong, assertive, then many people will say, oh, she's a bossy woman of color, or she is, you know, she's this and that, she's a man or something. But if she's not assertive enough, if she's too negotiable, and if she's too you know, agreeable, then that will be another set of judgment to be like, oh, she's not assertive enough, she's not qualified to be a leader. But I think, I don't think that's the same standard exists for men. And I do think different types of styles of leadership should be valued. And we're already doing that today in this forum, and I think in many of our spaces, but I don't think that has perpetuated in many other different cultures and countries in the world. So I'd like to also echo that.
We've got.
Yeah. So, hi, Jason. Just one very quick observation on the five. I have no particular interest in it, but just remember, five different countries, five different universities, five different native languages, different mother tongues, on three different continents. So there is diversity. May not look like it, but if we look a little bit beyond on the five finalists that we saw, it is different. The other thing is, we've been talking in these very kind of vague ways that we have dissatisfaction with the way power is distributed. And how many CEOs are there for the Institute for Canadian Citizenship?
Two.
One. Two?
Sorry. Two CEOs.
There's two CEOs.
Two co-chairs.
Okay. So there's one CEO with presumably some kind of ultimate decision-making authority. And there's presumably one Governor General of Canada at a time. And there's one President of Penn International. That's just the way organizations are structured. You know, whether it's large or small, there's going to be a concentration of power. So we can swap someone else out in that seat, but it's still just going to be one person making those decisions. So I'm going to violate the spirit of what we were supposed to be doing here and coming up with solutions, but tying it back to what we learned over the last two or three days, a potential way forward is, if companies are becoming a little bit more fragmented with the rise of technology, the rise of independent work, we can argue whether or not that's a good thing or a bad thing. Instead of having one organization with 10,000 people at the bottom and one at the very top making the decisions, we might end up with 1,000 or so organizations that have roughly 10 people in them, but one person at the top of each of them making decisions. So that could be a way forward, possibly, to democratize some of this power to actually make decisions, potentially.
We are officially out of time. But there are people who've been waiting to speak, and I wouldn't mind if we go over by 4 minutes. I know there's a comment there that's been waiting to come up. If we have, we do four comments, 30 seconds each. Then we'll wrap up.
Hello, I'm Hirata from Japan. I'm not sure if I can make it 30 seconds, but Japanese
Scott
people
is going to come over.
As many of you know. Sorry? So Japanese people rarely speak up in this kind of place. I'd like to talk about this inclusion from Japanese people's point of view. Japanese government is notorious for not accepting refugees. And there are many reasons for it, but one of the main reasons, in my opinion, is the fear towards the something that we don't know. And especially Japan has been a closed country, and still geographically, it's like isolated. So it's not like racism. We are kind of afraid of something that we don't know. So it applies to Japan very well, but it might apply to other countries as well. So I'd like to make a point that the first step we might take is to get to know the people or something that you don't really know. And yeah, and another thing I want to make shortly is Japanese society is trying to change. Like, even for now, we are not really good in English, and like also for some people from Asia country, we have some trouble in like communicating with the Westerners, Western people. And I sometimes feel kind of isolated in this community, partly because like I don't really have good ability in English. But Japan is trying to change. Like we start English education from earlier age, and we try to send more people to the foreign countries. So I'd like you all to ask, like, when you see Asian or like people from Asia or Japan, please welcome us.
That was good. Thank you. Here, and Maria, and you, and then we'll be done. Go.
Hello, everyone. My name is Stefan. I'm from Belgium. I would like to answer the question that was asked immediately in the beginning of this session. What would you do if you were to become prime minister or president of your country? And my answer would be very short, step down and give the power away. Not just once, because if I do that once, of course, well, there's nothing that will really change. But use the power that you have in that moment to give many other people that, because of the system being biased in favor of people with privilege, trying to change that towards a system that has that kind of counteracts this bias. There are many interesting ideas. If anyone is interested, I would love to talk about it afterwards. I will not do it now because then I would take way more than 30 seconds. But essentially, really not just getting people along that aren't privileged, but actually giving them the power to decide and not saying, okay, you maybe advise me, I listen to you, but in the end, I make the decision. No, you talk, you think, and you make the decision instead of me.
This is something that I feel that we, you know, we talk about like the like people from our developing world. For example, I would say Iran or Pakistan or all those countries when the government might have very different relationship international, but its citizens are suffering, and when we apply with those passports, we never get the visas or we don't get to travel. And I feel that traveling is very important for us to open up our minds, because I'm an athlete. If I was stuck in my village or in my area, I think I would have been the same, and I might thought everyone is against me, or everyone against Muslim, or everyone against, they think we are terrorists. But when I traveled, they came to know about me and I came to know about them. So traveling is very important, but because of our government, you know, Pakistan or Iran or all those, they can't travel because the citizens who are innocent, who don't agree with their governments, you know, you would know what's happening in Iran. But the thing is that they don't get to visa, and their visas are rejected without even paying attention. So what can do those people in power or those countries like European countries who are more in stronger position, and they can make a lot of changes to those kind of things? And then we see UN. UN is a platform where we think that they are the champions of human rights, but look at this. It's a hypocrisy, or it's a dishonesty. When everybody makes amazing speeches. I've been to the UN. They talk amazing speeches. You know, you would cry. Trust me, you would cry. And then I don't see that actually it is similar to their actions. Their actions are not the same. So you see. Saudi Arabia is in the Human Rights Commission. So you look at that, so how people are going to develop that trust? So those countries who are actually in stronger position, France, Germany, America, or Canada, England, all those countries, Australia, when they are stronger, all those very white countries, very much in strong position. If they can actually bring change to that, you know, first Saudi Arabia, make change to your country and then be in the Human Rights Commission, we will accept that. If we have some kind of criteria that people get trust, gain trust in these countries too, at the same time gain trust in the UN, I think things will start getting better in the other areas too.
Thank you. Last word, Argentina,
30
seconds.
Okay, like a tweet. I hear a lot about communication and social media, so I'm going to like say what I tell to my students of journalism. Social media is like technology. You can use it for good or for bad. So try to think how you can impact on other people through social media. And as I am on the last one, and we are talking, but we have also to act, I would like to do an invitation. We have a beautiful nature outside to take photos for social media. So my invitation is to take a photo of another person and tell her or his story in your social media to start giving voice to other people and not only about what we do, what we eat, or what we are so great people on the social media. Thank you.
Perfect. I just want to invite the Minister of the Ambassador of Canada, Susan Micheletti, to say a final word before we leave you today. Susan?
Yeah, thanks.
Ambassador?
You can call me Susan. Well, I won't prolong. I'd like to propose two things if I were Prime Minister. And please don't repeat this, okay? Walk the talk. So I'm a little biased because we kind of walked the talk in Canada. In 2015, when Prime Minister selected his new cabinet, we had gender parity, 50-50, women, men. One of the most important ministers in the cabinet is, well, you know, as a journalist, Chrystia Freeland, Minister of Foreign Affairs. Our chief scientist is a woman. Our new Governor General, Julie Payette, former astronaut, is a woman. And if you've heard our Prime Minister speak in Canada or internationally, he's just like a broken record. It's all about women. It's all about gender. It is something that he feels, and this government feels, extremely seriously about. So walk the talk. And this is not just in speeches, but also in real things. They've increased the taxes, and this is not about women, but they increased the taxes on the 1%. Again, we talk about redistribution. And this was part of their platform, and they did that. Okay, maybe you'll think it's not fast enough, it's not enough, period, but it's happening. We've elongated the maternity leave, and the paternity leave is now there too. So again, the budget, the last budget in Canada, has a gender-based analysis lens. And again, it is about everything has to be looked at through diversity, equality, and gender. So I think it's important for a prime minister or a president or any leader in a company to actually walk the talk. We talked about objectives, we talked about goals, quotas, etc. But they also have to be repeated. I've had a great time here today, going from high emotion to very conceptual discussions, intellectual, and it's all very human. And I think it's great. But I think we need to make sure that we have one or two things that we want, as we have done today, one or two things that we want to bring with us and implement. The only bad thing that I would say is that we're talking to the converted, and we've heard that before as well. And so we need to talk to the dissenters. What's happening around the world today, whether it's in Europe with the rise of populism, whether it's, you just have to watch some, and I'm not talking necessarily about CNN, but some other media outlets, it's there and it's real. We need to talk to the people who do not think like us. I think we need to make sure that they understand, and John Ralston Saul said it's about the fear. Well, it is about the fear, so how do we handle that? It's by explaining, educating, discussing, conversing. We can't just simply say, well, we are all know what we're talking about, therefore we're right. No, it's about other people too. And the gentleman there was very funny and but very real in terms of saying, hey, come on, you know, go and see how the other half lives, or the other 99% lives, before you tell them what to do. But I think it's important. And business schools, I agree, have to change as well, because they have to start thinking about the other, the disruptive elements, the human stuff that will have an impact on our society, and businesses have a definite role to play on that. So I will say, RPM does town halls. He has town halls. He stands up there and he gets bombarded with questions, and it's really tough. But he does it. Do you think he likes it? No, but he does it. And I think that's very, very enlightening about what Canadian values are and how Canadians perceive their role in internationally and domestically. So I'm rah-rahing about Canada. It's also part of my job, but it's also because it's a great country. And if you guys want, you know, to come over, let's have a party.
Thank you, Madam Ambassador. Some final words. Thanks to our onstage team. Thank you, Marty. Thank you, Upkar. Thank you, John and Adrienne, for guiding us through this day. Thanks again to the Coffee House hosts from this morning and our 360 speakers, Zabeen Hirji, Peter Voser, Yolkendi Valdez, Aya Chebbi, Alexander Dirksen, Alicia Cromer, for participating. And thank you all for staying with us on this beautiful day. I'd like you all to acknowledge that this entire event was put together essentially by three people, all of whom are standing. I mean that actually they're on their feet despite not having slept for days. Jean Rudolph, Linder, Scott Young, Aisha Jara, thank you so much for your work on it. I love the idea of doing social media out on the lawn with those flowers. I'm serious. If you have time, please join us. We'll take some pictures down there. I do need the final 360 people back here for a photo. And before we end the day, this is a collaboration, the first collaboration between the St. Gallen Symposium and Six Degrees. It was the result of Scott's friendship with Rolf Bachman, who came to Six Degrees in Toronto last September and said, you have to come and do this as an adjunct to our symposium. We were flattered and honored, Rolf, and we have also been enormously appreciative to you and Biat and Dominic and Jean-Rudolph for allowing this to take the shape it did and being patient with us. It's not that easy to take things abroad like that. For instance, this is by far the best stage we've ever had, and we have to leave it here. Unless somebody can check it, it's their luggage. At any rate, many, many thanks to Rolf and to the St. Gallen Symposium, and thank you all again. All right, Adrienne, I just need the 360 people here for a quick photo, and then everybody on the lawn, if you have time, for the social media.
Taking away all the mics. We're done.
So that was our St. Gallen Symposium, the
Symposium, the 6 degrees event was already done. Thank you all for watching and have a nice evening. See you next year.